Hi everyone, Tom here, and today I've got one of those Far East oddities with me. The watercooled, one-piece, all-metal hotend. Short, the OPAM. Now, this thing got to me in a DHL Express envelope, straight from Singapore, and by the way, DHL rocks for international shipping. In the package, I got the hotend itself, complete with a thermistor and a heater cartridge, polyurethane tubing, and a USB water pump. Though the final model will come with a tiny 12-volt pump that should have pretty much the same performance. The one-piece all-metal hotend itself consists of two parts, the all-in-one stainless steel block and the 3D printed holder. Now, the block combines all the actual functionality of the hotend into a single part. There's a fixed 0.4mm nozzle on the bottom, a heater block which has the heater cartridge secured with a grub screw and the thermistor potted in. Next up is the heat break and the cooler block, complete with a pair of pneumatic fittings on each side since there are two cooling channels through the cooler block. And lastly, the threaded connection to the printed mount. You could entirely skip the printed mount and just screw the block into your extruder or carriage if it's designed for it, possibly making for a very flat setup. Alright, so let's try to get this thing going. The OPAM is 66mm long overall, so it's shorter than, say, an E3D V5, but still longer than an EUV 6. But if you wanted to, again, you could easily replace the stock 16mm groove mount style mount with a shorter one or with any other design. The included one fits well enough into my standard universal clamp type mount, but I did notice that the printed part did not have a chamfer to make inserting the filament easier, so I added one. And please excuse me using a drill for this, I didn't have a small enough countersink at hand. But then when I tried to insert the filament, it still didn't fit in, this time further down the filament channel. So while the mount's bore was probably drilled out in production, it came out pretty far off center where it meets the stainless block. So, yeah, I had to open that up some more as well. And then, of course, when I was finally ready to heat this thing up, one of the thermistor's leads had snapped off, rendering the hotend useless. Now, a word on the included thermistor. The one that's potted in here is supposedly a high temperature type rated for 350 degrees Celsius, but I find that kind of hard to believe. One, because it's not exactly a brand name thermistor, but rather a gray market part. And two, because even the better thermistors aren't usually rated for those temperatures. Even though they will still work beyond the rated temperature, there's no guarantee they'll still be accurate and precise and won't further degrade over time. I would have liked to test the included thermistor against a thermocouple to see how well it does, but obviously that's not going to happen now. So, back to fixing it was. I went with installing an axial thermistor with glass fiber sleeving, which I think is the most robust way to get a thermistor into a heater block, period. The stainless used for the OPAM block turned out to be extremely easy to machine, so if you should run into the same issue of the thermistor breaking, I'd highly recommend doing the same mod. Well, I used a cheap MF58 thermistor, which has been working great for me in other hotends, and for normal use, you can install any other axial thermistor in the exact same way. So, when I finally had it mounted and wired in my printer, another thing I noticed, which I guess was kind of expected, was the fact that there is a pretty big lag between the heater cartridge and the thermistor heating up. Since the block is also made from stainless steel, which is a pretty bad thermal conductor compared to the typical aluminum blocks, it simply takes a while for the heat to travel from one end to the block to the other, which means that when heating up the side with the heater cartridge is already going to be scaldingly hot while the other side with the thermistor is still cool to the touch. Once the hotend is all heated up, this isn't going to be an issue in a perfect world, but in the real world it does make things unnecessarily hard on the PID loop, which is supposed to keep the actual temperature as close to the set temperature as possible, and with that rather long delay, it will only have outdated temperature information to work with. Speaking of PID loops, the Autotune functionality of Marlin had somewhat of a hard time figuring out the ideal values for this hotend, for the reasons listed above. On the first try, Marlin thought the hotend was defective since it took so long for it to register the heating and pull an emergency stop with the settings I typically use. Once I changed that configuration, it failed again when the OPAM overshot my tuning target of 250 degrees by a whopping 35 degrees. ending up at 285 degrees Celsius for a short while. Now, allowing more overshoot in Marlin is a bit harder since the maximum overshoot for normal hotends is hard-coded in there and not a configuration option. So I dug down to that snippet of code and loosened it up some more as well. But then, finally, even though the tuning took a while, the auto-tuned PID values did work reasonably well and had the hotend keeping its temperature to a few degrees within the target and limited overshoot to about 15 degrees Celsius, which is normal and okay. So after adjusting the nozzle height, I finally, well, I'm using that word a lot today, ain't I was finally ready to print. But sadly, it only took me a single print to come to my final conclusion about the OPAM hotend. It does not print well. I was going to test this with everything from PEK to NinjaFlex, but it seems that the OPAM is already having trouble with ABS, which I consider to be the easiest plastic for a hotend to handle. I do have a hunch about why this would be and why a different filament isn't going to make a difference, but let's first take a look at the 3D bench you'd printed, which, by the way, is actually a really nice test part, even though the design doesn't look that test-worthy at first sight. I'm going to compare it against a print from my typical E3D V5 printed with the same white ABS filament and G-code, since these are technically very similar hotends. The E3D print looks okay. It's not perfect by any means, and there are quite a few spots where the accumulated grime from the nozzle left ugly spots on the print. The OPAM print, on the other hand, just looks horrible overall. All the surfaces are spotty and everything but smooth. Contours were not as sharp and clean, and top surfaces just didn't fill in properly. The long, straight overhang also did not bridge all that well, which is the same effect as the top surfaces not filling. Vertical edges are all jacked up and just don't look good either. I'm going to overlook the stringiness of the print since fixing that just takes a small bump off the retraction length. Now, what probably causes the print quality issues here is the nozzle design. Not only does it stick out pretty far from the heater block, which means that the temperature at the tip might be quite a bit lower than the core temperature of the block, but the nozzle tip is also very weirdly shaped. It has a pretty short bore which causes the extra ooze, but then there's also a countersink where the filament is supposed to be extruded, and that just doesn't make any sense at all. This will just have the filament dangling between the point where the bore ends and the taper begins, and where it's supposed to get fused to the layer below it. I guess you could fix that by using a super wide extrusion width, but then again, that's not exactly the point of this hotend. And since the entire block is a single piece, you can't just swap in a different nozzle. And that single piece block, of course, also means that you can't swap any other part. If you bent the heat break, that's it. Time to get a new hotend. If the nozzle gets damaged or is super clogged, well, same thing. And you can't even disassemble it and thoroughly clean it. Nope, just throw out the hotend and buy a new one. So, a word on the entire water cooling thing. Yes, it is new and not that many companies have done that before. Why has no one done it? Because it makes absolutely no sense. You're going to have to deal with four things of tubing to your hotend, which, by the way, are very sure to properly route them out. You're going to have to deal with that bucket of water sitting next to your printer, and you're also going to have to deal with that pump's connector coming loose, which can possibly leaving you with a boiling hotend. It just likes to come loose when the tubing is moving around, since it's not secured in any other way than being jammed in. A zip tie can fix that. The advantages I see in water cooling just a single hotend are that the pump is not as noisy as a fan. You can use it in a fully enclosed and heated chamber, and you don't have the issue of the hotend fan blowing over your print where you don't want it to. Other than that, there's no advantage over, say, an E3D V6, and no, I'm not getting paid by them to say this. This is my honest opinion, and everything I say on here will always be. And, you know, for most users, even a regular genuine J-head is going to work just fine and will be way less hassle to maintain and set up. Also, compared to those two hotends, the OPAM is actually really, really heavy and has all its weight dangling far below the mount. The weight stated on the Indiegogo campaign is 40 grams, but I suppose that's just the stainless block. Mine weighed in at 70 grams, including the tubing connector and the heater cartridge, but not including the wiring or tubing itself. And once you add those and water to the equation, it's going to get another bit heavier. So the OPAM is currently listed for $60 for the first 25 sold and $70 for everyone sold after that. Add $10 of shipping plus imports and taxes, which worked out to over 30 euros for me, but of course might depend on where exactly you live, and you're way past what other genuinely premium hotends cost. Plus, ships from Singapore, so shipping times are going to be hit and miss. The ones you can buy on Indiegogo definitely won't ship with DHL Express. And as usual, this is a crowdfunding campaign, so there's no guarantee that it will be shipped on time or that it will be shipped at all. There have been so many crowdfunding campaigns, especially around 3D printing lately, that just completely went down the drain. So be aware that this is basically a modern form of gambling. After all, what are you going to do if a dude halfway around the world ends up not shipping or shipping a faulty $60 item? So, in conclusion, while the OPAM does many things differently than what other hotends are doing, and really, I like seeing innovation. The way it does these things differently just makes no sense at all, and doesn't make for a very pleasant experience. Maybe those 100 hours of testing were just not enough. I mean, that's just about 3 or 4 prints for each prototype of this hotend, which by no means can be enough to validate, optimize and fine-tune a hotend for every material it promises to print. So that's it for today. If you still want to have a look at the OPAM's Indiegogo campaign, that link is in the video's description. And while you're scrolling down there, leave a thumbs up or thumbs down, depending on whether or not you liked this video. If you didn't, leave me a rant in the comments about what I should improve on. If you really liked the video, you should probably subscribe to my channel because I'll be making 3D printing videos until the day I die. Well, maybe not exactly, but I always try to have at least 2 new interesting videos per month. Anyways, thanks for watching. See you in the next one.